My name is Mor Peleg. I'm from the University of Haifa, and I would like to tell you a little bit about the MobiGuide project. This is a large European project that started 2 years ago, and I'm its coordinator. It's a project that spans 13 different institutions, six universities, Haifa and also Ben-Gurion, and four in other European countries, two hospitals, three companies, and a patient organization. So our motivation is to ask ourselves, what do patients and their care providers really want? So think about a cardiology patient or a patient that is pregnant and has complications like diabetes and hypertension. The patients want to stay healthy and feel safe while continuing their daily life routine. They don't want to go into the hospital into monitoring sessions that are time consuming. And they want to, so what we do for them is we use these mobile applications, a smartphone that is connected to wearable monitoring devices that can assess through biosignals how they're doing and can proactively alert if there is anything wrong with the patient. There is a decision support that we operate on the mobile phone and also on a back-end server. It's two different systems that are distributed and interactive. And the decision support that we provide is based on evidence-based clinical guidelines. The system learns from the way that patients are doing, and it tries to evolve the guidelines and to improve them based on the outcomes that we measure. The system is secure, and it is meant to be available anytime, everywhere. So not only when the patient sees the doctor, but also when the patient is in between visits. And therefore, to match this ability, we use this distributed decision support system. We give automatic decision support that is specific to the patient clinical data. And we keep all the data from the sensors and from the hospitals, in an integrated patient health record. The decision support is not only suited to the clinical parameters, but also to personal preferences and to patient context. Things that we know about the patient, like his support by family members, his financial situation, his ability to communicate with the doctors, etc. So in this talk, I will try to give you a little bit of taste of the MobiGuide system, show you two small scenarios in which we use the system. And I would like to focus a little bit about this personal context. Just to mention, we also support shared decision-making by care providers and patients. And you can understand that the name of the system, MobiGuide, draws from the mobile part, the monitoring devices and the mobile patient, and the guidance that we provide to patients and their physicians. So if you think about traditional decision support systems, you see the guidelines on the top right, and what we do is we represent them formally in a computer interpretable guideline language. In the middle, we have a decision support system that reads this medical knowledge and compares it to patient data from the personal health record, and it matches the knowledge with the data going in one of the particular pathways that is specific to the patient data. And the decision support is traditionally communicated to the physicians in interactive sessions through web-based environments. And we have this, but in addition, our goal is also to provide decision support to mobile patients. And this needs to be anytime and everywhere. So what we do is we give the patient the mobile phone and wearable sensors, like a belt that is worn over the chest. We integrate different sensor input to the personal health record, in addition to data that comes from hospital electronic medical records, and in addition to decision support recommendations that are delivered to the patients and care providers by the decision support system. And I will focus about the personalization of the medical knowledge. Just to show a top-level functional architecture, you see in the middle the distributed decision support, the mobile decision support system, and the back-end one. You see in the blue the patient body area network of wearable sensors, the PHR, the data storage and collection on the bottom, the security, the knowledge collection and storage, and above the user interfacing. And of course, this is a very simplified view. It is more complicated. And we have over 20 interacting components. One of the scenarios that we worked on in the first year was from atrial fibrillation. It's a cardiac problem. And we see here the patient Mary that has been feeling symptomatic recently, and she goes to her doctor and she asks, can you help me somehow because I feel insecure? So he gives her the MobiGuide system, the cell phone, and this wearable belt. It's not a watch, it's something you wear over your chest. And the system tells her, please measure your vital sign, put on the heart rate belt, and turn it on. When ready, please press the start button. And then you can see the heart rate on the left, on the right, the level of activity intensity, because you anticipate that you will have a higher heart rate when the activity is higher. And in the middle, it shows that it's measuring atrial fibrillation events. And what we do in the background is we collect the heart rate measurements, and we try to find these peaks, which can be atrial fibrillation events, and we look for them in 1 minute intervals. And to increase our specificity, we look whether we can see two positive intervals over 10 consecutive ones. And if so, then the patient will get a question, what level of palpitation, what symptoms are you feeling? And if she presses this middle button of unacceptable level, the system will tell her, now take this emergency pill from your pocket, and this is a good time to take it. So until now, you've seen a glimpse of the MobiGuide system, but you haven't seen any personalization. This is all based on clinical data. So what we are doing, and I'll focus in this talk, this is work with Adi Fuchs, who's here in the audience, and Pnina Sofia. And we're trying to get to better adherence by the patient by tuning the system to their preferences and their personal considerations. So after we formalize the guidelines, as you see the clinical algorithm here on the right and some formal decision criteria, we customize these guidelines to groups of patients, catering to different personal considerations that occur often in patient populations. For example, it can be that the patient from time to time has non-routine schedule, and if she's a diabetic patient, this makes it very difficult to continue the exercise plan and the many types of measurements that you need to do, measure your blood glucose several times a day. Then we continue to personalization that is done between the doctor and the patient during the first visit, and then execution of the personalized system. So in customization, we add some recommendations that are not based strictly on the guideline, but are based on personal context and other context that is external to the guideline knowledge. What we look at things that there are many different treatment options to the patient, and his clinical parameters make the first selection, narrowing down this space. And the personal consideration narrow it further, recommending different decision options that are more suitable for the patient. Ah, sorry. Here on the right, you can see that Adi conducted over 16 interviews with patients and different healthcare professionals, doctors, nurses, social workers. And from that, he created an ontology of the different personal context factors and their effects on medical treatment. You can see some of the personal context considerations here, like financial situation and the family support and diet considerations and so on. So here's an example of how we can change the guideline knowledge. You can see in this table that we have different kinds of knowledge on the left. In the blue, we refer to the clinical knowledge. You see that it's the same in the two rows. The patient This is gestational diabetes, diabetes in pregnancy, and the patient's metabolic control is not in a good shape. This is in both rows. In the first row, the patient has a routine diet and is able to follow all the recommendations. In the bottom line, it is a semi-routine diet, for example, when the patient is traveling or on holiday. So in the normal situation, we expect the blood glucose value not to go over 120 milligrams per deciliter, and we expect her to exercise 3 to 4 times, at a level of 6 metabolic units, and to measure her blood glucose 3 to 4 times a day. On holiday, we relax these considerations. Measurements go down to 2 to 3, and exercise goes down. And in concordance, we expect that the blood glucose level can go a little bit higher to 140. So we put these different plans into the guideline, and we activate them based on the personal context which the patient is able to activate. Before the patient can activate, the doctor and patient together look at the different patient contexts that are defined in the clinical guideline, in the electronic guideline, and they give personalized names to these contexts. For example, the regular, the meal schedule in purple that you see here, the meal schedule is routine. We call it the regular schedule of the patient. And the meal schedule semi-routine can be her holiday schedule. And this is for people who like to relax in their holidays. The situation can be reversed for people who have a very relaxed daily life, and during holidays they like to do a lot of activities. Other things that we do in personalization, we let the patients provide their preferences for choosing major branches of the guideline when there is shared decision making that is actually recommended. And we let them set priorities and preferences, like when should they receive reminders for taking measurements, which in diabetes is related to meal schedule. So when do you have usually your breakfast and lunch? And then we will send you a reminder for the pre-breakfast measurements, 15 minutes, 30 minutes before it, depending on what the patient wants. So to show you the last scenario, and here you see Montse, and she has gestational diabetes. She's indicated that she has now entered her regular schedule. And she's enrolled in the system. She gets the smartphone. And in day one, at 1:30 p.m., she gets this reminder to measure her blood glucose value 1 hour after lunch. She does so, and the glucometer broadcasts the results. And she abides to this recommended measurement schedule for 3 days. And the system sends her feedback that you're doing actually very well. The system can monitor her behavior, her compliance to measurements, her compliance to the exercise, and also reporting of excessive carbohydrates, which means that she is not compliant to diet. And the system can send the personalized reminders to the patient. It can send the patient feedback messages and education material. And it can notify doctor when they have to intervene and be in touch with their patients in between visits. So this is all, and just to thank the many people that are involved in the MobiGuide project.